So today we're going to look at the future of technology through 15 charts, mental models, concepts, and laws.
But why?
As you know, we are in a technological revolution. If you want to stay current, if you want to keep up with the change, you need to understand the change, understand the context. So in this video, we're going to explore 15 models, graphs, and laws that will help you understand this context. Because if you don't, how can you even pretend to talk the language of technology? So let's kick off with a simple one, the customer adoption curve. The process of new technology adoption over time is typically illustrated as a classical normal distribution, what we call a bell curve. We call this the customer adoption curve. Fun fact, the first one came from the Subcommittee for the Study of the Diffusion of Farm Practice in 1957. This customer adoption curve states that new tech is sequentially adopted or not by these psychographic characteristics. First, the innovators, then by the early adopters, then the early majority, then the late majority, and then the laggards, who are also known as phobics. The customer adoption curve has been adapted many times, notably by Geoffrey Moore in his book Crossing the Chasm, where he highlights that the most difficult move for a product or technology is to cross the chasm, the gap between the visionary early adopters and the pragmatic majority. So essentially, to make or break your business, you're going to want to cross that chasm. You can also relate this chasm as being similar to what Malcolm Gladwell calls the tipping point. To illustrate this even more, here are where some technologies stood in the customer adoption curve back in 2016. The next concept is S-curves, which is quite similar. S-curves are a beautiful model to represent the gradual adoption of innovation over time. They were originally theorized by Foster in his 1986 paper. He argues that the adoption of technologies generally follow an S-shaped curve as the product moves through its life cycle, typically with three phases: the early adoption, growth, and plateauing. I love Benedict Evans' twist on this. He says that the three phases are actually stupid, exciting, and boring. In this illustration, we see past and present innovations as represented by an S-curve. Electricity, refrigerators, VCRs, microwaves, cell phones, and the internet. Now back to Benedict Evans. With our current IT revolution, we've been through four S-curves: mainframes, PCs, web, and mobile. Mobile is currently getting into the boring phase. For example, how exciting was your last iPhone update? So the question, if you want to be a visionary, is what is the next phase? Is it going to be life sciences, bio and nano, for example? As with all models, you see flaws, and flaws to the S-curve have notably been outlined by Clayton Christensen. Which brings us to his disruptive innovation model. He says that the flattening of S-curves is actually firm-specific. It's specific to each firm rather than each industry. He argues that if technologies plateau within certain companies, it's the company's fault and not the industry's fault. Because some firms demonstrated the ability to wring far greater levels of performance from their existing technologies than other firms. Whereas large firms that pursue aggressive S-curve switching strategies, that try to switch to the new paradigm, gain no strategic advantage. But let's look at the actual model. Christensen's model believes that new technologies, if they are to overcome the old ones, the old tech, actually are going to take root in simple applications at the low end of the market that tends to be least profitable for the larger companies, for incumbents. Netflix and Uber are good examples of this. Then the model explains that these new entrants are going to relentlessly move up the market, eventually displacing established companies. It's similar to that term we love to repeat. Startups are trying to nail distribution, mass market adoption, before the corporates can nail the innovation. So if you look at the diagram contrasts product performance trajectories, that's the red lines showing how products or services improve over time, with customer demand trajectories, that's the blue lines showing customers' willingness to pay for performance. As incumbent companies introduce higher quality products or services, that's the upper red line, to satisfy the high end of the market, where profitability is the highest, the problem is they're overshooting the needs of low-end customers and many mainstream customers. Think about robo-advisors in fintech, for example. This leaves an opening for new entrants to find footholds in the less profitable segments that incumbents are neglecting. Entrants on a disruptive trajectory, the lower red line, improve the performance of their offerings, and little by little, or really rapidly, they move upmarket where profitability is highest for them too. Basically, they're challenging the dominance of the incumbents. Another interesting but often highly criticized graph for adoption of technology is the Gartner hype cycle. The Gartner hype cycle is a graphical representation to represent the maturity, adoption, and social application of specific technologies. The cycle says that technologies go through five phases: the innovation trigger, the peak of inflated expectations, that's where most of the hype is, the trough of disillusionment, that's like a bad hangover, the slope of enlightenment, that's kind of like the recovery, and the plateau of productivity, that's when the technology or the product has been adopted. It's the golden age. Now, this hype cycle has been widely criticized for a bunch of reasons. It's not really a cycle. The outcome doesn't really depend on the nature of the technology itself. It's not really scientific in nature, and it doesn't really reflect changes over time in the speed at which technology develops. But I still think it's a powerful mental model when thinking about upcoming tech. Some examples you can remember, for example, the AI winter, or if you remember what happened around cryptocurrency back in 2017. I really love to use it to get an idea of where a product or a technology stands with regards to hype. So also please check out this beautiful infographic produced by the Visual Capitalist that attempts to map the biggest hypes for each year. For example, do you remember the hype around autonomous vehicles, machine learning, the connected home, or digital twins and deep neural networks? So based on everything we've said so far, you might feel like industries are being disrupted, or new technologies or incumbents are highly likely to be disrupted, which is why it's interesting to also look at the LINDY effect. So the LINDY effect is a theory that the future life expectancy of non-perishable things, like technology, or like a business, or like an idea, is proportional to their current age. So every additional period of survival implies a longer remaining life expectancy. So for example, if a business is 100 years old, it should expect to be around for another 100 years. And a business that has been around for 10 years should be around for another 10 years. Of course, this doesn't apply to humans. If I've been around for 70, I probably shouldn't expect to last another 70 years. Under the effect, the mortality of a business actually decreases with time. So the longer a technology lives, the longer it can be expected to live. But of course, don't let this effect make you complacent. Now, speaking of the lifespan of technologies, hype cycles can be interesting to understand what type of market you're entering. And what do I mean by what type of market? Which brings us to the Blue Ocean Model, a marketing theory, and the title of a book published in 2004 by Kim and Moborin, professors at INSEAD. They separate product launches into two types of strategies, red ocean strategies and blue ocean strategies. It's asking you the strategic question: do you want to jump into a saturated market or a novel one? Do you want to beat existing competition or start to build a monopoly from scratch? A monopoly sounds great, right? But it still has risks. Do you want to exploit existing demand, or do you want to create and capture a new one? Do you need to educate the market, which is difficult? Because the more novel an idea, the more novel a technology, the higher the risk. The more saturated, the lower the technology risk is, but the higher the competition risk is. The Blue Ocean strategy seems to show higher risk, but also much higher reward. And as this model is quite binary, the Purple Ocean strategy was also developed to serve as a sort of middle ground. Next, we're going to look at Deloitte's digital disruption map, which is also quite powerful. Certain industries are more impacted by change at any given time than others. We actually love this model created by Deloitte and their expression short fuse, big bang. It's basically a matrix that maps out on one side the potential for disruption and on the other side the timing. When will it happen? Now, Mark Andreessen likes to separate the world into two types of industries: those that have benefited from productivity gains of software, which means those that have been disrupted, like retail, media, or finances, and those that haven't benefited from productivity gains yet, that haven't been totally disrupted yet, like construction, education, or healthcare. Now, to define disruption, Deloitte looked at things like the extent to which products and services are delivered physically, the likeliness of customers to use digital channels, the importance of broadband and computing infrastructure, how mobile a company's customers and workforce are, the significance of social media, etc., etc. And then what's great is they start plotting all of these different industries on the matrix. Now, the model was built specifically for Australia, but it's still a good model to position yourself. Here, for example, we see that finance is in the short fuse big bang, same thing with real estate, arts and recreation, and retail. Long fuse big bang, which means the impact will be huge, but there's still a little bit of time to come, are in things like health or education, agriculture or utilities. So explore the model and see where you position yourself. Now, most of the disruption recently has been happening through software eating the world. Now, this is in large part due to two things. One, which is access to data, which we'll talk about in a little bit, and the other one is computational power. Now, to understand the increase in computational power, it's important to understand Moore's law. The observation was made by Gordon Moore, who's the ex-CEO of Intel, and who actually never designed it as a prophecy, but it's turning out to be a prophecy. Okay, the complicated version first. Moore's law originally said that the number of transistors per square inch would double approximately every 12 months. So really, basically, we expect the speed and capability of our computers to increase every couple years, and we will pay less for them. More powerful computers and cheaper computers. Computational power is becoming a commodity, like electricity or running water. Moore's prediction has proved accurate for quite some decades now. Some are saying that we've reached the limit of Moore's law, and others are saying that we're going to go through a paradigm shift and Moore's law will continue to be true. Now, one of the things this increase in computational power has allowed is the Cambrian explosion of deep learning. The Cambrian explosion was a biological event that happened approximately 541 million years ago, which resulted in a major diversification of living organisms. Now, what does that have to do with today? NVIDIA's CEO, Jensen Huang, likes to talk about a current Cambrian explosion in deep learning, making AI so much more powerful and diverse in recent years and in years to come, notably with explosions in image recognition capabilities and natural language processing. This has been made possible by three main factors: increasing computational power, key algorithms that existed since approximately the 80s, and access to mind-blowing amounts of data, both structured and unstructured, because of our never-ending use of the internet. So I know we just went 541 million years in the past for a few seconds, and let's put things into perspective for the past couple hundred years. As you all know, this is not the first time technological revolutions take place. Carlota Perez, in her book Financial Markets and Technological Revolutions, which, by the way, I'm putting in the box of beautiful books with terrible names, she explains that there have been five distinct major technological revolutions since the end of the 18th century. And even more interestingly, she explains that these revolutions seem to all follow a similar pattern of deployment, like a liftoff, a bubble with a recession, and a gradual comeback renaissance that's a sort of golden era, a golden age. The first of these revolutions, which happened around 1771, came with the introduction of factories, water power, and a network of canals. The second upheaval from 1829 was based on coal and steam, iron and railways, which created the entrepreneurial middle class. From 1875 came the age of steel, heavy engineering, with the proliferation of transnational railways. Some see it as the first globalization. Then 1908 came the Model T Ford and the age of the automobile, oil, plastics, universal electricity, and mass production. And then there's our current revolution, the IT revolution, which started around 1971, the year that Intel's microprocessor was launched. So what's really interesting is that each of these revolutions followed three similar phases. First, there was the installation, with the eruption and the frenzy phase. Financial markets fell into sort of a bubble. This was followed by the turning point, the crash, the recession. And then third one is what she calls the deployment, where you have synergy and maturity. This is kind of a golden age. So this is interesting. If the pattern continues, where are we now? The model states we've already been through the installation, eruption, and frenzy phases. We've had or are having our recession with the crash of 2000 and 2008. So the question is whether we can now enter the golden age of deployment. And this will probably happen once social, economical, and environmental incentives start to finally align. Now, what's interesting is that Perez also identified that for each revolution, some countries, some geographical regions were more powerful than others. For the first one, the power was within Britain. For the second one, it stayed within Britain and it started to spread to the United States. For the third one, the USA was the superpower and Germany started to overtake Britain. For the fourth one, USA stayed the superpower and it started to spread back to Europe. And then in the fifth one, we see the USA as the superpower with it spreading to Europe and Asia. So why is this important? I like to repeat that technological power is economic power, which is basically geopolitical power. So it's interesting to look at where the power is nowadays. Let's look at these charts on market capitalization of companies. Of the top 20 most valuable companies in the world today, 14 are in the USA, 3 are in Europe, and 3 are in China. But let's also look at the fact that of the world's 10 most valuable companies, 7 of them are tech companies. So where is the tech power nowadays? Well, if we turn this around and look at the top 20 internet leaders of the world, 11 are in the USA and 9 are in China. So it's pretty clear where the power balance lies nowadays. It lies within the USA and spreading to China. So what is it that makes these companies grow so fast? Why can they grow exponentially and disrupt incumbents? One of the things that explains this is network effects. And one of the laws to explain network effects is Metcalfe's law. Metcalfe's law is also crucial to understand our current technological context. The law states that the effect of a telecommunications network, like a phone network, is proportional to the square of the number of connected users of the system. Or put simply, every time you connect another person into a network, and therefore that person is able to make many more connections, the impact is multiplied. It's not linear, it's exponential. So it doesn't go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It goes 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, etc., etc. It allows for faster spread of networks. It's interesting to see that in 2015, three Chinese academics, Zhang, Liu, and Xu, tested Metcalfe's law on data from Tencent, which is China's largest social network company, and on Facebook. Their work showed that Metcalfe's law held for both, despite the fact that Facebook was serving a worldwide audience and Tencent only serving Chinese users. Which brings us to the next law, which is Reed's law, which is even more ambitious, even more exponential. Reed says that group-forming networks increase in value at a rate of 2n, where n is the total number of nodes on the network. Now this is important. The reason why Reed suggested a formula of 2n instead of n2 is because the number of possible groups within a network that supports easy group communication is much higher than 1. So basically the total number of connections, what he calls the network density, is not just a function of the total number of nodes. In reality, it's a function of the total number of nodes plus the total number of possible subgroupings or clusters. In a nutshell, Reed's law believes that even Metcalfe's law understates the value created by a group-forming network. So we're not looking at linear growth, we're not looking at exponential growth, we're looking at exponential growth on steroids. Oh, and by the way, these laws are not true laws in the same way that the law of gravity is a scientifically proven law. They're simply math concepts that describe the different relationships between different types of networks. Let's also talk about the long tail effect. A long tail is a type of distribution in statistics. Chris Anderson applied this distribution to explain the new opportunities that the internet offers. He talks about the head of the curve and the long tail. Anderson found that in online markets, lots of niche goods tend to outsell fewer hit products. He found that the tail gets longer and longer because everyone can now produce content, niche content. He also found that the tail gets fatter and fatter because everyone can also distribute their content. For example, in media, large movie companies would focus on huge blockbusters, whereas new online companies like Netflix are able to focus on the long tail of niche interests. And that's what made them powerful. Same thing with retail. Before the internet, it was difficult for large physical retailers to stock many small niche items, so they needed to focus on bestsellers. But then they weren't tapping into the entire long tail of the market, whereas online catalogs like Amazon allowed for very specific niche products, tapping into many, many small unmet needs. And we're actually going to end on a scary note with the danger formula by Yuval Noah Harari. In a recent talk at Davos, Yuval Noah Harari, the author of Sapiens or 21 Lessons for the 21st Century, came up with an interesting yet kind of scary formula. The formula is B times C times D equals A, A-H-H. What does it mean? Biological knowledge multiplied by computing power, which we covered, multiplied by data equals the ability to hack humans. If you know enough about biology and have enough computing power and data, you can actually hack my body and my brain and my life, and you can understand me better than I understand myself. So the idea is that as we keep moving forward in this technological revolution, it might not just disrupt economics or philosophy or politics, it might actually also disrupt our actual biology. And this could be the next frontier, threat or opportunity. That's it for the 15 models. Share the ones we forgot in the comments. That's really helpful. Also, please, if you want to support us, like the video, subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you really, really soon.